Okay, why don't we begin? This is the August 19th, 2014 meeting of the board. The board will be considering tonight's agenda in the following order. There will be approval of the minutes from our July 15th meeting. Then the town planner has a report, followed by Harvest Lane Private Road Extension. Then we'll hear from the Cardinal Lane Private Road Extension and Resource Protection Permit, followed by Sea Salt Market Site Plan Amendment, then public comment on items not on tonight's agenda, followed by adjournment. So first item was approval of the minutes. Do I hear any comments, questions about those minutes? Then anyone like to make a motion?
Move to accept as presented.
All right, thank you. Second, thank you, Carolyn. Any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, all those in favor? And all those, were you not here? Okay, so you won't be voting on this, okay. All right, then the next item is town planner's report.
Thank you. Just wanted to take a moment because I have some, what I consider to be good news. Last Monday night, not yesterday, but a week ago Monday, the council held a public hearing on the normal high water line amendment that the planning board worked so very hard on for so very long, and they adopted what the planning board recommended. So, congratulations. The second I just thought is a piece of information, particularly for Peter. The Town Center Plan Committee has completed their report, and one of the recommendations in that report, there were 7 recommendations, and one of them was to update the Town Center stormwater plan and to start with a plan and then implement the infrastructure. Earlier this week, the town was notified that we've received a grant from the Coastal Zone Management Program to do that stormwater plan update. So that's it for me.
Thank you. Okay, next item on our agenda is the Harvest Lane Private Road Extension. Nick Tamaro is requesting a 90-day extension of the approval that was granted on May 22, 2014 to complete easements required as condition to the approval under Section 19-7-9B, New Private Road Standards. This is on our consent agenda, meaning that if anyone would like to have a discussion on this, we would have to have a motion. So at this moment, would anyone like to make a motion to take that off consent agenda? Not seeing anyone, would anyone like to make a motion for the, thank you, Joe.
Be it ordered, motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the request submitted and the approval granted May 22, 2014, the request of Nick Tamaro to extend the approval of the Harvest Lane Private Road Extension / Resource Protection Permit for 90 days be approved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Carol. You might want to use your microphone, Leanne, on those two.
For the boards, there was an error here. There is no resource protection permit for the Harvest that. Road Private Road Extension. That was a mistake on my part, and I would humbly request that you delete that portion of the motion.
Okay.
Would that be okay with me? Thank you very much. Okay, all those in favor of the motion? Okay, that's unanimous. Okay. Next item on the agenda is the Cardinal Lane Private Road Extension and Resource Protection Permit. Susan Gabriel is requesting an extension of Cardinal Lane, located off Cross Hill Road, to provide access to a new lot and also a resource protection permit to alter 4,220 square feet of RP2 wetland to construct the extension. This will be heard under Section 19-7-9, Private Road Public Hearing, and also under Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Regulations, and we will be having public hearing. Okay, and this will be heard in this following format. The town planner will provide an overview of the item, after which the applicant will summarize any changes made to the plan. The public is then welcome to comment on the road extension and resource protection permit, and after public comment, the board may begin discussions, concluding with a motion for the board to consider. Maureen.
Sure, and following the theme from the last item, I wanted to make sure that everyone had received my amended memo. Reusing forms, not always the best idea. Under item 11 on page 2, road construction standards, the paragraph that was sent to you is wrong, and the most recent paragraph that was sent to you is more accurately reflecting what is in the plans. Right now, the applicant is proposing to take an existing gravel road, which is 22 feet wide with an 18-inch depth of gravel base, and extend that road another approximately 400 feet. No waivers are being requested from that road design. The board did also receive comments from the Conservation Commission. The commission met on Tuesday night, provided comments on Wednesday morning. I believe you have those. And there are some recommended conditions of approval for the board to consider, and there's some flexibility, obviously, with these conditions, but the board may want to make some decisions about whether they're concerned about issues or not. There is a very clear note about the building envelope being labeled. Been having ongoing conversations with the code enforcement officer, and he has strongly urged me and us to make sure that notes are very clear on plans so that he can enforce what your intent is. He has reviewed note number two and has given me the okay that he understands that that means you can't clear vegetation outside the building envelope. So if that is your intent, this note should work. It has an optional planting of additional vegetation because there are a few places on the proposed lot where vegetation has been cleared, and if the board wanted to fill in those areas, then you would need to be able to plant additional vegetation. If you're not asking to fill in those areas, you could leave that out. I've also pointed out that there's a question about potentials. There's a proposal by the applicant to create two additional utility stubs for a future Lot 5. And the concern is that where those stubs are coming out at the end of Cardinal Lane could potentially result in alteration very close to the RP2 wetland. So the real intent of Condition 4 is that those stubs be relocated in such a way that we can minimize or avoid any alteration close to the RP2 wetland. Condition 3 is an offer for your consideration to implement the Conservation Commission's recommendation that there be a buffer established for the remaining RP2 wetland. And then this is a private road. There is already a private maintenance agreement on it, but because you're extending the road, we need to make sure all of the road is covered that under that agreement, and that Lot 4 has rights to use that road. Since it's a private road, those things have to actually be deeded. So that's what's before you this evening.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates, representing Suzanne Gabriel. To summarize the changes that we've made in our latest submission to you, I'm just going to review our July 31st letter that identifies those changes, beginning with, and Maureen has mentioned a few of these, but beginning with Maureen's comments, there were three. Stormwater was one, and this was also one of AMAC's comments. They wanted us to provide, in addition to the post-development calculations, they wanted us to provide pre-development calculations, which we've done, and they have agreed with. The second item is, and we discussed this at the last planning board meeting, had to do with the property line on the proposed property line for Lot 4 in this location here. If you remember, we had it, there was a straight line that intersected the right-of-way line of Cardinal Lane. We have modified that boundary line to allow a future extension of Cardinal Lane, although the applicant has no intention of extending it. We did that as requested by the board. And the last item was Maureen asked us to include a copy of the master plan that was prepared years ago when we started this project, and that is in your packet. The following page are our responses to AMAC's comments, and they're all pretty minor. We've addressed all of those comments on these revised plans. And then the last item was a comment that we discussed at the last planning board meeting with regard to an alternative road location. And I've indicated there are five bullets here indicating why, or basically summarizing our analysis of that alternative road location. The first had to do with site distance. It's very poor site distance at Wells Road and where the driveway, the existing driveway, is located, or where a proposed road would be located. It's poor site distance in both directions, especially looking in an easterly direction. It really doesn't meet the subdivision standards. The second item had to do with the pond that is located on Sue's property, located here, with a significant amount of emergent wetland surrounding it, and would absolutely have an impact on that wetland. It would be a greater impact than what we're proposing. The third item had to do with the road would require a 4/10 of an acre additional clearing within the woodland. The fourth item, there is no public sanitary sewer in this vicinity of Wells Road, and it would mean that we would have to extend the sewer as we are proposing now, so it would have an impact on the wetland. And the last item, I believe that you all received an email from Ms. Muger, who is the immediate abutter. And in that email, she indicated that she would not be in favor of granting access rights for the second means of access. So that's a summary of the revisions that have been made. Since our last submission, we received another memo from AMAC with some additional comments, which have all been revised on these plans. And the last item has to do with the wetland buffer. As Maureen indicated, the Conservation Commission met and reviewed the plan and recommended a 50-foot buffer along this wetland area here, as well as the drainage flow area, the swale. And as you know, there is no requirement for a buffer for an RP2 wetland currently on the books. And this 50-foot buffer on either side of the drainage channel would significantly impact the future Lot 5. It would remove 39,450 square feet of upland area within that lot, and that's assuming that it was an 80,000 square foot lot, that would be 49.3% of that lot area. And I mean, we just feel that 50 feet is excessive and really unreasonable to ask. It's going to make this lot a lot less appealing to a buyer. And we have in the past used 25 feet as a rule around a RP2 wetland. This is really, I mean, it's very narrow. It's very, there's no stream out there. If you went out there right now, it'd be dry. So we just feel that if we're going to put a buffer, we'd like to put 25 feet around the wetland. versus 50 feet.
Excuse me, John.
Yeah.
I just want to be clear that wetland is RP2.
Yes.
So the buffer would be an additional 25 or 50 or whatever beyond the edge of the wetland.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah. So the you know, this dash line here represents a buffer.
John, can I ask another question? Did you actually have that entire wetland delineated, or are you just assuming? My understanding is that you had the wetland delineated in the area generally of the road, but that there
right.
may be quite a bit of other wetland
and there
on
was,
both properties
right.
that actually are not yet delineated. Is that correct?
That's correct. And what we did was, first of all, I talked to Al Frick, who did the delineation, reviewed that with him, and we brought up a topo, and it delineates the drainage swale on the topo, and that's what we're using. I did this because I wanted to show the board where this swale extended.
So we're just kind of assuming that the drainage swale is, in fact, RP2 wetland, kind of as an extension of the part that was better delineated.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
What about wetland around the pond? Has that been delineated?
No.
No, okay. That was what I recall.
No. So, and also the 25-foot buffer is the standard buffer along a DEP jurisdictional stream. It's what has been used in the past, and we would like to use the 25 feet rather than the 50 feet. I think that pretty well summarizes all of the revisions that have been made. I'm glad to answer any questions.
Okay. At this time, though, I do need to do something on completeness. So at this time, I do need to ask if anyone from the public would like to come up and speak on whether or not this application...
Public hearing.
Public hearing on completeness. Are we doing completeness?
Right? We did last week.
Oh, okay.
Right idea.
So I do need to have
okay.
public hearing.
Sure.
It's not on completeness. It is actually on the entire application. So if anyone from the public would like to speak on this application, please come forward. And seeing no one, I will close the public hearing, and now I'm going to send it to the board if you have any questions for John. Yes.
I have a question regarding the gaps that may or may not need to be filled in as buffer. Any feel for how wide these openings are between these properties that are being suggested that may or may not require additional buffering? Between the Laughlin property and this new lot, and between the Munger property and this new lot that were mentioned?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Are you asking how much buffer would there be?
No. Yeah. How big are these gaps? Are they 10 feet? Are they 5 feet? Are they 2 feet? Are they 30 feet?
The gap?
How big are they? The gaps that are being... Okay. Yes. Please,
right.
Maureen.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. On the plan you submitted, you suggest a tree line. And if you look at lot 4, and you look at the building envelope for lot 4,
right.
outside the building envelope, there's a couple of places where there's a break in the tree line. Basically, it looks like someone's been mowing a path around Ms. Gabriel's property. So if you were to create a building envelope, most of that envelope is going to be buffered by existing vegetation, according to your tree line. But there's a couple of places where there would be no buffering. There's a gap between lot 4 and the Mugar property, and a gap between lot 4 and the Laughlin property. I'm looking at it. I mean, if this is to scale, it looks like it's in the range of 30 to 40 feet.
In total, or?
Well, it looks like the one next to the Laughlin property is narrower This is a scale of 1 inches equals 60, so it looks like that the Laughlin property gap is maybe 20 feet. And then on the other side, it's bigger. I don't know if John has that. John, it's sheet two might show it.
That scale, the narrowest point scale is 10 feet, and the widest point scale is 50 feet.
50 feet, that would be drawn between lot four and the Mugger property?
That would be from lot, between lot four and the Mugger.
Mugger, I'm sorry. Okay, everyone catch that? Okay.
I ask because we did our site walk and we know it's a pretty well forested area. And is it, I want to make sure, is it reasonable to ask for additional buffering or is it unreasonable to ask for additional buffering is kind of where my brain's going with this.
Yes. So.
Well, I will say that this tree line was in that location, because we didn't survey all the way out, that tree line was taken from an aerial survey. And I don't believe, so you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't believe that there is a distinct pathway like that. I think there's a canopy of trees that covers this, what is being graphically shown.
I don't remember seeing any big gaps when we did our site walk.
Yeah.
So I just want to be reasonable in our assessment of this.
Okay, Carol Ann's question was about the size of that, but does anyone want to follow up with any questions or have any comments on whether or not there's a desire to add additional buffering?
I have some questions about the original master plan.
Liza, could you use your microphone?
Oh, yeah. I have some questions about the original master plan. Do you happen to have that?
Yes.
On the computer?
No.
No.
I don't.
And I remember hearing initially that the wetland was not delineated for the original master plan, I think because the applicant didn't want to do a master plan and just decided to, you know, cleave off two lots and not be subject to the subdivision ordinance. I don't know if that's correct or not, but what are these various things on here, like the little curved things, is that tree cover?
Yes.
So that's tree cover.
It's
true. Like there's tree cover right on the wetland. All right, so there's no wetland on here that was on the initial
correct
sheet called master plan?
Correct.
Okay. And so there was, so was any wetland filled in on lots two and three to build the private road?
No.
Or the lots?
No. There were no wetlands.
No.
No.
And I did talk to the DEP, and it sounds like if indeed wetland was filled in on lot one, it was before the current rule of 4,300 square feet. So I did have that discussion with them, and it would not, so anything done before 1990 wouldn't be subject to the 4,300 square foot rule. Where would you have put the, knowing where the wetland is now, had you delineated the wetland on the entire property, what would you have done differently? I'm just curious with where you put the road.
Probably because we're not catching her on the microphone,
yeah.
It'd probably be best if you would like to answer that question.
I'm not sure. I mean, it may have been like this.
Yeah.
Or we may have, modified the road somewhat to go around it.
Yeah. Was any consideration made to perhaps buying land from the Laughlins to move the road now to not fill in the wetland? I know that you were looking at alternatives.
Right. No.
No.
It was not.
Okay.
Their lot is 80,000? acres, 80,000, the minimum lot size.
Oh, it's minimum lot size?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I guess those are my only questions.
Okay. I don't feel like we've finalized the buffer. I just want to finalize that before we move on to the wetland, because I have some questions around the wetland. Does anyone want to discuss whether or not we want to add plantings in these areas that are depicted as open? Comments?
My reaction from our sidewalk is that the area is fairly heavily forested or grown up with a lot of underbrush, and it wouldn't be clear to me where plantings would reasonably be required. There didn't seem to be any open visual passages that needed attention. Just my own personal reaction to the circumstances we found.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with Pete.
All right. Any other comments? Okay.
And I agree. I don't see the necessity for asking for additional buffering.
All right. Then, well, I think it's in our conditions when we get there. Just make sure that we're not reading about additional plantings. Okay. Now that we've discussed the buffering, I do want to move on to the issue around the wetlands. As far as the Conservation Commission has given us a recommendation for the 50 feet around an RP2, we've heard from the applicant that they prefer 25 feet. Now I'd like to open up to the board on your thoughts and comments on this issue. Yes, Elaine?
I was just wondering if Maureen could share with us the discussion that the Conservation Commission had, why it went to 50 feet, and I'm particularly concerned, I guess, about our putting a wide buffer around essentially an unmapped wetland. So I don't know what discussion they might have had, but it would be helpful.
I'd be happy to do that. I did want to make sure the board understood that in the ordinance, right after the standards for issuing a resource protection permit, there's a section called Resource Protection Permit Conditions, and it says the planning board may attach such conditions to the granting of a resource protection permit as it deems necessary to carry out the purposes of the ordinance. Such conditions may include, but shall not be limited to, one, establishment of a buffer between a resource protection two wetland protection districts and adjacent uses, structures, and activities. So it's not often you find such an explicit authorization in the ordinance. I felt I had to share. The Conservation Commission meets the second Tuesday of the month, and I am their staff person, so they review the planning board agenda items that relate to resource protection permits in open space when they're before the planning board. They saw this application last week. They went over where the road is, where the wetland is. I think what I would say is they were disappointed that the development of this property hadn't proceeded as a cluster development. And as a cluster development, the entire property would have had its wetlands mapped, and it looked like there was an opportunity to minimize or avoid the wetland if there had been a big picture plan. They let that go. They understand that they have to deal with the here and now, what's in front of them. And their concern was that because of where the road has to land, there is a section of wetland east of the road that is, for all intents and purposes, marooned. And there was general acceptance that that wetland was not going to be very high value anymore. And because that piece is being marooned, they said, well, let's at least make sure that the piece west of the new road is going to be, yes, you got it.
This is east.
What's being east? The little piece, yeah, the piece, there's a small piece east of the new Cardinal Lane. And, you know, it is going to be connected to the rest of the wetland by culvert, yeah. But, you know, by the time you finish building the road, it's really going to not have a lot of value as a wetland. It'd still be protected as a wetland, you really shouldn't alter it. But their thought was that, okay, if we're going to lose this amount of wetland, then let's at least make sure we're not going to damage any of the wetland that is left. And that's why they talked about establishing a buffer on the RP2 wetland west of the road, and they want to protect that entire corridor. So we don't really know if that drainage corridor is just a corridor, if it does have some associated wetlands with it. But that's why they talked about they wanted a buffer. They talked about 25, 50, 100 feet. The feeling was that 50 feet was a robust buffer that would have some meaningful protection for the RP2 wetland that's left. So that was their rationale behind that.
Thank you. Elaine?
Was there any discussion, just based on our sidewalk? It looked to me, if we're looking at important wetland, that there's a lot of wetland around the pond, which could conceivably even extend into this lot. Was there any discussion of that, or was it just focusing up here?
No, they didn't go on the sidewalk. They should have been notified by me that there was a sidewalk, and some of them may have been able to attend. They did have a discussion about, you know, how valuable is an RP2 wetland, and some people were like, you know, if it's, there was one commissioner who said, you know, if it's not really, really wet, he doesn't really think it's that valuable. And there were other commissioners who felt RP2 wetlands are valuable, they're valuable for wildlife, they're valuable for other reasons, and we should be protecting them. And I think this was a recognition that this property owner has moved forward with development under the current ordinances, that there doesn't seem to be any option left for avoiding this wetland alteration, short of saying, no, you can't do this with your property. And so they came around to this, then we think that we ought to be serious about protecting the wetland that's left. But no, they didn't really look at the pond. They're not that familiar with the site. They're only looking at the area that we had decent mapping for.
Joe?
So does this map, though, just represents an approximate idea of where the RP, right? It's not actually mapped.
Well, from this point up to the top, that section right there was based on topography.
Okay.
Everything else was mapped.
Is everything else in the area of the road, but not the entire property?
Excuse me?
Everything else in the in this corridor was mapped, but there may be other portions of the property that have wetlands.
No, Al Frick looked at the remaining portion of the property. I asked him to look at the remaining portion of the property and to map any additional wetlands above and beyond what we have mapped. So he has looked at the rest of the lot.
But the pond's not mapped.
The pond, no. This was just within this developed area, not outside of the proposed development.
So, clarifying question. Is it fair to say, John, that then everything that's marked as wetland was mapped?
Was delineated.
Was delineated, but there may be other wetlands that are not delineated.
And that section was not.
Okay.
And that's what I'm saying is, I wanted to graphically show you where that finger extended to. So I used the topography to do that.
Okay.
Just one more.
Yes.
So if I understand you correctly, there is no other wetland on lot 4 at all?
That's correct.
Okay. So he did take a look at the entirety of the proposed lot 4?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. That's helpful.
So, I want to...
One more question. So, to develop lot 5, the applicant would need to come back to the board, right? There's no...
Not necessarily.
No, because the road is... Okay. We're only seeing this because...
The road can create frontage.
Right, we're looking at a road tonight and the resource protection. That's why they're here tonight, so they could do another lot. To answer that. So we have Conservation Commission recommendation. Caroline?
I'll go on record. I think a 50-foot buffer is excessive. I think it's taking of somebody's property and devaluing their property.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
I'm a little concerned that we're making some ad hoc policy here of saying it's got to be a 50-foot buffer. There is no, I take it, marine policy within the town, either written or informal, as to buffers, how big they should be, and so forth.
No, it for RP1 there is.
Understood.
For RP2, it's really this: the board can establish a buffer. You have established buffers as tiny as 5 feet, in very, very compact sites. You've established buffers as wide as 100 feet on very large, expansive sites.
Right, and I guess what I'm trying to focus on now is John's point on behalf of the applicant, that the 50-foot buffer would create quite a bit of difficulty in sensibly developing Lot 5. 50 feet, 25 feet, I'm not sure I find any magic number, and so I guess I am somewhat inclined to say that something less than 50 would be appropriate, if for no other reason than it would really disfigure Lot 5 for purposes of development.
Thank you. Question, Clinton Road, did we establish a buffer around that pond? And what was that?
I think it was 10.
Was it just 10?
Where was it?
Clinton Road?
It was the very end.
I think it was 10.
Was it 10 foot?
I think you're right.
All right, just kind of...
Yeah, it was 10 feet.
It was a 10-foot buffer? All right, just I'm trying to pull back what we have done. Okay, and I'd like to hear other people. We've heard two on record, but I want to hear from other people.
Yeah, I agree with Pete that 25 seems fairly reasonable.
Okay, Liza?
Yeah, I agree that 25 seems reasonable too, and I think, you know, by ordinance, the Conservation Commission was supposed to look at this. They took the time to do it, and so I do feel like, and they are the experts, so we should take their advice seriously. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, 50 does seem significant. And also, because they're filling very, planning on filling very close to the 4,300 mm-hmm. square feet, they fill just a little more. It's going to trigger DEP review. So we have some protection there.
Okay. All right, so I think we have, unless anyone has another comment they would just like to add to the record, I think we have a majority then that is saying 25 feet. Is anyone?
Did you say 25?
That's sorry, Carolyn, no. I'm sorry. We have three.
I didn't say any number. I said 10 because the answer to the
yes.
Clinton Road question.
Then I, so. Lane, would you like to go on record with a comment or Henry?
I guess my question is, I think we need to go ahead and resolve this. I'm troubled by establishing a buffer around an unmapped wetland. On the other hand, I see no need to require the applicant at this point to map wetland on a lot that may or may not ever be developed. That seems like a waste of money. So I'm kind of torn what to do. I think 50 feet is excessive. I'm almost inclined to establish the buffer not on the drainage part of the wetland, which we don't really know what's valuable and what isn't valuable there. So that's what I'm having problems with, but mm-hmm. if the majority want to go with 25 feet, I think that's fine. I just think it's...
I will say that...
It's kind of random.
There will be a note on the plan, because this plan will be recorded, there will be a note if it's 25 feet, there will be a note that will require a potential future buyer of Lot 5 to maintain a 25-foot buffer.
Around what? A drainage ditch?
Around a wetland. Around the wetland found on Lot 5.
So I guess what I'm still confused about is have we or have we not found a wetland along that drainage ditch? Is it a wetland just because drainage happens there? Does that make it an RP2 wetland?
Unknown.
It's unknown. So I guess what we would have to say is if that lot were developed, that wetland would have to be mapped. And if it were found that it is not just a drainage ditch, but actually a wetland, then they would have to establish a 25-foot buffer. Because at this point, the only wetland that we really know is there is, I think, what you have in this dotted area on your map.
And the finger extending up, it's on your plan.
And yep. Yeah, but that's part of the dotted area on the
correct.
Map.
Correct.
So it's kind of a two-step process. We're drawing an actual line, mm-hmm. 25 feet, around a portion, and then the other one comes later.
And Maureen?
I just want to clarify that the proposed condition number 3
yeah.
explicitly says wetland and drainage channel. So that if you established a buffer and you use the format of condition 3, it doesn't matter when the drainage channel
if it doesn't become a wetland, because there still would be a buffer from the drainage channel.
And do we ever put buffers around drainage channels?
We put, I mean, the state requires that streams have 75-foot buffers around them, so it's not unheard of. There's a 30-foot no-cut buffer in Cranbrook adjacent to a stream, so stream...
But is a drainage channel a stream?
It can be, yes.
Is this one?
Is this, but it might not.
No, this is not a stream.
And this is the thing. This is, we're using language that is broad and not specific, because we do not have specific information on this application.
So it seems to me that this is a question for the development of Lot 5, most of it.
Al Frick, in his letter, which is included in your packet, indicated there are no streams on this property.
I always suppose they could come back if they wanted to amend the site plan. I saw Henry first, and then we'll go back over here.
Yeah, sorry. I remember to pull it down. I noticed you said it would there's a possibility it would be orphaned by building the road. Is there any other results of building the road that we haven't heard of? What else will it do to that ground? I mean, you're going to take a certain amount away. There's still going to be the same amount of rain falling in that area. It's still going to be that low. I know you have a channel under the road, but is he going to extend it out? Is he going to push it away? I mean, it's got to have some effect on it, and I haven't heard what effect it's going to have on it yet.
We have, there is a proposed culvert underneath the road that connects the small wetland on the east to the larger wetland on the west.
Yes, but using the road area, and you've now got a certain amount of ground that no longer can be wet because you filled it in. And what so is it going to extend the, it can't absorb that amount of water without either extending in some direction or going deeper. In other words, there's a certain volume of water it has to be able to take to become wetland. Is the wetland going to extend to the right? Is it going to extend to the left or what?
No, it will not, the wetland will be channelized. All the water will flow off of the proposed road. The wetland that flows on the runoff that flows on the eastern side of the road will be directed into the culvert and flowed
into the small area that was said to be orphaned.
Right, will enter the culvert and be directed to the larger wetland on the west side.
Does that mean that this part of the wetland, because of the culvert, will grow? Because you're using a certain amount of ground space to build the road. I mean, you take a bucket of water, you put something in it, the water has to spread somewhere. And I don't know, looking at this, what will happen.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there will be a driveway on that side. There will be clearing. There will be a lawn area. It will be maintained. Lot 4 will be developed in the vicinity of that wetland. So it's unlikely that wetland is going to grow.
Can I jump in here?
Well, I thought I saw a hand over here first.
I just want to help John answer this question.
Okay. And we'll go back. Yes.
You go to the Mitchell & Associates memo, and you go to page 6. You will see the pre- and post-calculations of the flow. And that shows that the additional flow created by the impervious surfaces is negligible and will not expand these wetlands at all.
Okay, so thank you for the answer.
Okay, yes, Peter.
I take Elaine's point about the a buffer on a wetland which hasn't at this point been precisely identified. Correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, I think something is or is not a wetland based upon the soil and vegetation having certain characteristics. So if one was to want to delineate that in Lot 5, it could certainly be done. And on that delineation, there would be a buffer we impose on it of 25 feet. So it's something that can and would come into being if the lot was proposed to be developed. And certainly this creates a not only a regulatory issue, but a title issue. Or if the person wants to develop Lot 5 and mortgage it to build a house, they're going to have that area carefully delineated on their mortgage plot plan and so forth, so the lot can be developed. So I guess it doesn't bother me at this point of saying there will be a buffer zone on a area of land which is, we're not quite sure where it is, because when the need to accomplish this happens, it can readily be done.
Actually, I would agree with that point, that when they go to sell it, because as you know, you can't just fill in an RP2. So when they go to sell this lot, if they sell this lot, somebody's going to have to go out there and survey this so that a future landowner doesn't go in there and destroy an RP2.
Yeah, in addition to that, I think this will be a condition of the approval, correct?
Sounds
like so. It will be on the plan, will be in the records. When Lot 5 goes to build and get a building permit, the code enforcement officer is going to look at the record, the plan, and realize that it's going to require to have a 25-foot buffer. So there's a...
Yes. I feel comfortable with it. Caroline?
As far as the RP2 wetland goes, I can get on board with what's been said. The drainage channel, I have an issue with. If it's not an RP2 wetland, if it's a dry drainage channel, except in certain circumstances, why would it need to have a 25-foot buffer? And unless it's proved to be an RP2 wetland. And I kind of go with, I'm kind of getting on board with what Elaine is saying, and tell me if I'm following you correctly. But is there a way to, I would like to take the drainage channel out. If it's proved to be an RP2 wetland, fine. If it's not, it's a drainage channel. I live on a property that has a number of them, and they flow only when necessary, and other than that, they're dry. So.
During
a heavy rain.
On the drainage channels? You haven't built on the drainage channels, though, have you?
No, we don't have buildings. We have drainage channels, but right. we have things happening within closer than 25 feet.
Yeah.
Because they're used to drain and channel water. They're not RP2 wetlands.
Yeah, but I think if we didn't have a buffer for the drainage channel and we had nothing about the drainage channel, it is conceivable that the drainage channel could be built upon.
Then they would be very remiss in their choice of location for their home.
They get it wet every time it rains.
Well, the drainage channel is just a small portion of that, right, at the very tip.
Yes, Elaine.
Would it work if we said that there would be a 10-foot or 25-foot buffer around the delineated wetland here, other than obviously the wetland that's in the roadway, which I guess we're giving up on, but it's all wetland in the remainder of Lot 1. That the wetland in the remainder of Lot 1 that's delineated would have a 10-foot buffer, and then say, in addition, no further development shall be permitted on Lot 1, which is everything other than that could be a future lot. No further development shall be permitted on Lot 1, which disturbs any remaining wetland on the lot.
Say that again about
this. Okay, so basically what we're saying
so lot
is
one.
Around the wetland that has now been delineated on Lot 1, because we're not talking about wetland on Lot 4.
Right.
We're not talking about wetland on the road, is my understanding.
Right.
So, and Lot 5 doesn't exist yet.
Right.
So, the wetland that's delineated on the plan on Lot 1, mm-hmm. there'll be a 10-foot buffer around it. And in addition, no further development of Lot 1 shall be permitted, which disturbs any other wetland found to exist on Lot 1. Which basically says if there is future development on this property, at that point it would have to be determined whether wetland existed or not. And no more would be permitted to be disturbed, because what the Conservation Commission has said is, by doing this road, we're already disturbing all of the wetland that should be permitted to be disturbed in this vicinity.
Okay, as we wordsmith our motions here, I'm not sure...
That's the concept.
Okay, I'm not sure if I'm on board with just a 10-foot, for my reasons, which I can explain. And as far as, I'm trying to write this down, no further development on Lot 1 should be permitted that disturbs any wetland. I agree with that, because we don't allow any development on RP2, so that's a given. I would rather just, I know that if anyone wants to build on the master plan Lot 5, because we've asked this to, you know, do the right thing, look forward, they would need to send somebody out there to survey this land for the reason that John mentioned, is that the code enforcement officer will take out this plan right here, not the master plan, but the plan that shows Lot 1, and it'll say, oh, you know, there's a buffer around any wetland and drainage. Has that been? Let's look. Oh, no, it hasn't been. So we got to send somebody out to survey that, and then you'll have your answer, and you'll have your instant buffer. It'll be whatever, 50, 25, 10, whatever we end up deciding. But I am comfortable that it will, because it'll end up as a condition of approval. Somebody will need to go out there and delineate the rest of that.
But in fact, we do permit development on wetland. We're doing it right here.
With a permit.
With a permit, but it's right. but it so is allowed. And what we're saying, which is what the Conservation Commission has told us, is there's been enough wetland disturbed in this entire original parcel. And so basically what we're saying, and it's not clearly not binding on any future planning board, because they could clearly amend it as we can amend anything, but what we're saying is, in permitting this road, we as a planning board have reached the conclusion that no other disturbance of any other wetland should be permitted. And so if the developer of Lot 5, should it come to that, or Lot 1 for that matter, if there's any new construction proposed on Lot 1, that if once again an RP2 resource protection permit is requested, what we're saying is we're advising the future planning board they should say no, being mindful of what's already been disturbed. That's my understanding of what the Conservation Commission is essentially saying. They're also going farther and proposing a 50-foot buffer around a drainage ditch that may or may not be a wetland, may or may not be a stream, which I think is excessive. I think it's excessive to do that for 25 feet, too, because it's unmapped, it's unevaluated.
I think that was what Carol Ann was bringing up. If I'm correct, you may feel that possibly a buffer may possibly be okay on RP2. Maybe, may not. Drainage, though, I thought I heard you saying that's excessive, and now I think I'm hearing you say that's excessive. So I want to now just focus on the drainage ditch. Henry, do you want to weigh in on whether or not you would put a buffer around that, or we can go right over here?
Well, I would like to know really whether it's a drainage ditch or RP2, really, to be honest with you, rather than assume something or another. I think we need to know, but then it's going to hold everything up. So,
right. So if you had to make a decision...
I would go with a small buffer, not a large buffer.
Around RP2 and drainage.
That's sorry? Not if it's drainage, yes. But as we don't know whether it's a drainage or not, that's the problem.
Okay, so we have three noted drainage. I'm going to go over here now. Would you put a buffer around RP2 and or the drainage?
Yes, I would put it around. Primarily, the applicant has suggested it, and it's it meets the Conservation Commission's recommendations halfway.
Peter?
Yeah, I would support the smaller buffer. I'm not troubled by having the buffer on the drainage ditch, particularly if the applicant doesn't mind, because a drainage ditch does not exist independently of the RP2 district. Evidently, water will sometimes go from the RP2 via the drainage ditch, so it's not...
It's connected.
Yeah, they're connected, and if that can be buffered, you know, so be it. If the applicant was steadfastly refusing, then we might be hard-pressed to require it, but if they want to do it, I think it makes sense, because the two features are, in fact, connected.
Liza?
I'm for protecting both the ditch.
Okay, we have three and three, and I will have to say, I'm going to go with the recommendation, I'm going to go with what the applicant is saying, I do feel that it is important, and sort of as a bigger picture on this whole thing, it's very unfortunate, I would agree with the Conservation Commission, that when the original lot, the first time you developed this lot, and you had a private accessway, and then you started carving it up, and it is unfortunate that we didn't have ask for a master plan back then. I think the planning board's getting better at that, kind of looking towards the future, because there was a possibility that this is a lot of land, that it could have possibly had the road go in a different location, we'd be talking about less disturbance, and that opportunity is gone, and so going forward, I appreciate that you are saying, yes, we're willing to add some type of buffer because we have disturbed a lot of wetland, and I appreciate the fact that you are looking at that. And so at this point, we will be putting a motion in a condition about buffering both, and now I want to talk about how wide that buffer should be. So we've heard some difference, and I'm going to go right down again and try to have a discussion on that. Applicant is saying 25, Conservation Commission is saying 50. What does the rest of the board say?
It sounds like 25 seems to be the consensus. I could go with a smaller one, but I will go with the group, and the applicant is willing to go with 25, so I would vote for that.
Carolyn, thank you. Elaine, we're going to go right down the line.
Is the applicant, in fact, willing to go with 25? That's what you've been talking about. Is that something that works for you?
25 feet. Want to say something?
Yes, unfortunately.
When I bought this, where I got this land after I got divorced, I talked to Maureen. It was like a great. I didn't want to be a developer. I couldn't afford to be a developer. So it wasn't an option for me to go in there and do any sort of major development, but I did sell land to one for Cross Hill with the idea that I would have access for a road and utilities from Cross Hill Road, and I had a certain time frame to do this. But as I was doing this, I was getting advice that this was the right thing to do and that I could do it. I can't do anything except once every 5 years. So, it just sounded like maybe you're thinking that I was trying to skirt the system, but I feel like I've been a very responsible applicant for each one of these steps since early in the 2000s. So,
I'm just curious, who gave you the advice to cleave off a lot every 5 years?
That was that was what we just said.
An attorney.
Yeah. The main law.
Yeah. I know. And it's not what we want to incent as a town, because then you don't have something that's planned, but certainly that's your private right.
But at the time, I wasn't doing anything wrong by doing it.
Like minimizing your taxes. It's everybody's right, so. Yeah.
As a planning board, I think the majority probably has a philosophy of looking long-term and planning and open space, really big concept ideas, because I think what I'm hearing is that when they put Cross Hill in, we now know Wells Road is a bad access point. We now know that you'd have to disturb probably more wetland. We know that the site distance is not adequate. Cross Hill already had the utility. You did make a good plan to say, this is where I'm going to start with the accessway. But now we know that if you come in and say, I want to put one lot, I want to get into the Cross Hill, because it makes sense. This is a good access into this larger lot. We probably would have said a master plan just in case. And you still could have done it every 5 years.
Which we did. We did the master plan.
You did a master plan?
You have a comment?
Okay, probably not the best master plan we've ever seen.
No. I mean, we didn't go in and delineate, didn't survey the entire property, delineate all the wetlands. I think that's what you're getting at, right?
Yes.
But we did do a, it's a conceptual master plan of how the road would be placed and how the lots would be arranged. A very conceptual master plan.
Okay. I guess I'm not seeing.
The one thing we didn't do was to delineate the wetlands.
Okay.
Yes.
And we're getting better at that on our end, so yes. So that's all I'm saying, and that's why I'm for let's try to put a buffer now around it, because it is a shame that we didn't delineate what we now know is a town we're all in favor of protecting.
I'm in favor of protecting things too, but by like a 50-foot around the drainage area, the canal or what you call it, it seems way excessive, and it is kind of like when I go, I do want to sell lot five. This is like part, you know, at some point, just because this is the end of the, I don't want to do anything else to my property. I like where I live because it's like it is, and you've all seen that. So it's like, but these four lots that come off Cross Hill, a lot of people have retirement plans. This was mine. So when you compromise a lot that I'm not even thinking about doing by making these deeded restrictions, that it seems to me that it's reducing the value of the property before I can even, I'd be happy at the time when I do lot five to do it, to have it all done like just like we did with this one and do whatever is proper at that point, but to make excessive or like, I don't try to make a buffer around something that's beyond what we're even talking about seems difficult for me to understand.
I appreciate that. And I think the board has agreed that 50 is large. So they are in agreement with you. And now I'm at the point where I am going to continue to go down the line and ask people.
Okay. But
the question was, how did you feel? And does the board feel that they've, do anyone have a follow-up question? Or?
I do.
Yes, Elaine.
Okay. I think I need to respond to some of what was said, because to me, this smacks of a penalty for the applicant doing something which was completely consistent with what's permitted by law. And if we were starting this all over again, and we were just selling out, we were looking at selling out the first lot here, I wouldn't have said that you can't sell whatever this first lot here is unless you map the wetlands on this entire parcel. And that's kind of the implication I'm getting from what some people are saying, that we're now doing it differently. I think that what the laws allow is for somebody to take a big parcel and once every 5 years to sell off a part of it without complying with all the subdivision requirements. So our wetland ordinances, and if you need a wetland permit, that's separate. But it seems to me that what's been done here has been done in accordance with all of the legal requirements, and we're kind of putting a penalty on that after the fact. And I think it's still permissible, completely permissible, to do what this applicant is doing. We may be more sensitive to wetlands than when she started out, although I think Kate's been sensitive to wetlands all along. But I'm troubled by the implication that if you have a large parcel like this, before you can sell out a single 2-acre parcel, you need to wetland map the entire thing, thinking about what might be future development. That's what I'm hearing people saying, and I strongly disagree with that.
I want to make
that point clear. I would prefer to do a 10-foot buffer to a 50-foot buffer, but I won't vote against the ordinance, against the approval for that purpose. I just think we're overreacting here.
Liza?
No, if the wetlands were delineated, then maybe they wouldn't be coming before us asking us to fill 4,220 square feet, which is just under the 4,300 square feet allowed by state law. So I don't think this is about you should have delineated first. It's just that now they're coming to us because they're not allowed to fill the wetlands without a special permit. And the Conservation Commission by law needs to look at it and make a recommendation, and we can put additional conditions on. And if we don't have this kind of review, it's going to be death by a thousand cuts for our wetlands, and they're important for our ecology.
Yeah, and I just want to follow up. I agree with you. What she's doing is legal. I agree. We went through the subdivision. We had a long review. We know what you can do every 5 years. It's legal. No one's implying that what you did is illegal. It's legal. And I'm just saying that I wish we could have delineated, and I wish we did a master plan like we did on Clinton Road. We asked that applicant to do a master plan when he kept insisting, I am never going to develop back there, because I think we're getting better at looking long-term at possibilities, and I'm not penalizing. I don't feel that protecting an RP2 with a buffer is it's not a penalty in my mind at all. So it may be in your mind, because I think we look at land use a little differently, but this is not a penalty at all. So just to be clear, so.
I need to mention something. I apologize, and when Elaine was talking, she reminded me. In the very corner of the hammerhead, right there, we have allowed enough room for the driveway to come off in that location. I talked to Bob Malley a couple days ago and asked him if what he prefers to have the driveway, whether it be off the end of the cul-de-sac or off the side, not cul-de-sac, hammerheads, or off the side of a hammerhead. He clearly said that he does not like to have driveways coming off the end of the hammerhead, because that's where snow is stockpiled. So I left enough room at the end of the hammerhead, and it will not impact additional wetland, but I have reduced the setback to the wetland to 10 feet, just in that one location, and then from there it would expand out to 25 feet.
You're actually jumping now onto what I also wanted to talk about, which is that water main, but yes, let's...
Yeah, so I've never really heard the answer to Elaine's question, which is, are you okay with the 25-foot buffer? I mean, did you pick that number because you thought it would be a compromise that would be acceptable, or have you looked at the site and you feel that the site can accommodate a reasonable structure?
Well, I mean, we felt that 50 foot was excessive, and it took away a lot of, you know, almost a half an acre of wetland. That number I quoted is, took away upland. That number that I quoted is all upland. It is not any wetland. So it was a compromise between what the Conservation Commission recommended and what we have done in the past for RP2 wetland.
But do you feel that site is adequate now, or would you think it would be, I mean, you could leave some buffer and still have an adequate site?
Yes.
Just looking at
I think we felt that 25-foot buffer was reasonable and inadequate. Okay. Except for this 10, just as I said, in this very tip of the hammerhead, there's enough room to allow a driveway to extend off the side. I'm sorry I didn't mention that earlier.
And you're now getting right into the sewer force main and the water lines.
Yes.
Would they be located 10 feet away, or are they?
Well, they would be located within the driveway.
Okay, so...
No closer than 10 feet to the edge of the wetland.
So if I'm hearing correctly, John, then near the driveway and also near this force, the sewer force main and the water utility stub, I'm hearing 10 feet would actually be what you're looking for, and then you're okay with 25 feet away from that area?
Correct.
Is everyone following where that would be? And, okay. Now that I'm hearing that's what the applicant wants, what does the board say in response to that? We're going to start down with Liza instead of putting the pressure on Carol Ann Burchard.
So it's really 25 feet?
It would be 10 feet where the driveway is 10 feet from the drive, from the wetland.
From the wetland.
To the driveway area and those, the water stub.
Correct.
And when you get away from that area, then it begins 25 feet.
Correct.
10 feet from the wetland, how far?
In the vicinity of the driveway and the water.
That driveway would come off the end of the hammerhead and take a immediate bend to the left.
I guess I'm not clear.
Excuse me?
Are you talking about that latch area?
Yes. Yes.
I'm not clear.
So I'm estimating that from the western edge of the proposed right-of-way, the first area, the area within 25 feet of that western edge, any RP2 wetland would only have a 10-foot buffer. And then more than 25 feet away from that road right-of-way, the buffer could increase to 25
Correct.
Feet?
Correct.
Okay, so does that make sense?
And that will be...
That's essentially a length of that.
No, what it means is if you... Pointer, maybe? If you look at that western edge of that right-of-way, and you head west, you go west 25 feet.
That way.
And any wetland that's within 25 feet of that right-of-way would have a 10-foot buffer. Beyond the 25 feet, the buffer would go to 25 feet wide.
And that can be shown on the plan.
What did you say last time? All the way, okay. And I'm going to go, Peter?
I would be fine with 10 feet for the area indicated and then expanding to 25.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay, Lane?
I think it should be 10 feet all the way, but...
Okay, so we had 1, 2, 3. Carol Ann?
I'm with Elaine, but like Elaine, I will not hold up this application for that reason.
And then I'll be the fourth one to say I will go with the 10 feet and then changing it to 25. So actually, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, Henry, because Liza wanted 25 all around, and I'm hearing 2, 10, so...
Yeah, I got to say, if the applicant really wanted 10 feet, I would be inclined to move towards that.
Does it have
just to make things complicated?
Well, I kind of like the 25. Liza's going 25. You guys are going lower. So, Henry?
Yeah, as this
Henry,
is
use your microphone. You want to catch what you
said. Sorry. As it isn't developed, I mean, if you come up with a development plan later on, you still have to survey this particular area.
Yeah, you do.
There may be more areas in here which are wet, and it may pale to insignificance, the actual buffer around this particular piece of wetland. So, you know, 10 feet, and I assume for the want of anything better, 25 feet around the edge, if the applicant's happy with that, that's fine.
As Suzanne just suggested, what about 25 feet around the, you know, the delineated wetland and then 10 foot on either side of the drainage channel?
The board. Thank you. I'm seeing a majority shaking.
Compromise.
With a compromise around that. 10 feet around the drainage.
Around the larger wetland.
25-10.
Yes, it is. It's 10, 25, 10. Yes. The board is all following that?
Yeah. I just want to know who's wordsmithing this.
Who's making that motion?
Guess who's.
So I think that's a majority and a compromise on this board, because I know the board has varying
right
opinions around this. So, okay. Then I'd like to move on from that. So you've actually, John, also addressed local water stuff and, okay. The last question I had for you, John, was there is a planting schedule on this map, on this plat.
Yes.
I wanted to know the purpose of those plantings there on the roadway, if you could just explain it to me.
Well, it was, you know, we, in order to keep the total quantity of impact to under 4,300 square feet, we steepened up the side slopes off each side of the road slightly. And it was a way to help mitigate those steep slopes.
Okay. I was just curious.
Yep.
That was all the questions I had. Anyone else on the board have any more questions? Okay. Then at this point, I would like to hear a motion. Anyone dare? We can help anyone else who, someone with questions.
Thank you. I'll just try it out.
Yes.
Wing it. All right, so findings of fact. Our motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Suzanne Gabriel is requesting an extension of the existing Cardinal Lane private road and a resource protection permit to create road access to a new lot, which requires review under section 16-2-3 of the subdivision ordinance and section 19-8-3 resource protection permit. Number two, the town engineer has recommended that additional information regarding the sewer extension be added to the plan. Number three, the Conservation Commission is recommending that a buffer be established to protect the remaining wetland. Number four, the applicant has substantially addressed the standards of the subdivision ordinance, section 16-3-1 and section 19-8-3 resource protection permit standards. And I believe the subdivision ordinance only applies here for the private road because this is not subject to the subdivision ordinance. Okay, therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Suzanne Gabriel for an extension of the existing Cardinal Lane private road and a resource protection permit to alter 4,220 square feet of RP2 wetlands be approved, subject to the following conditions. Number one, that the plans be revised to address the recommendation in the town engineer's letter dated August 13, 2014. Number two, that the building envelope be labeled. A note should be added to the plans restricting activities outside the building envelope to installation of a driveway, installation of utilities, and planting additional vegetation. The total area to be altered for the driveway and the utilities shall be shown on the plan. Outside of the areas, no vegetation will be removed outside the building envelope. Number three, that the plans be revised to add a 25-foot buffer around the wetland with the exception of a 10-foot buffer within 25 feet of the western edge of the driveway, future driveway, in what is currently lot one, or of the road, okay, of the private road, and a 10-foot buffer around the drainage channel located west of the proposed road and extend to the west property boundary, as shown on the illustration from the Conservation Commission. No removal of vegetation shall be permitted in the buffer. Number four, that a note be added to the plan that there be no road construction until a performance guarantee has been provided to the town in accordance with section 16-2-6 of the subdivision ordinance, and number five, the plans be revised and submitted to the town planner for review and approval prior to recording the subdivision plat.
Does anyone like to make any changes to that? Yes. It was complicated, so I'm sorry.
Number three, I think the reference at this point to the Conservation Commission illustration creates a little bit of a problem because we're no longer following quite what they're talking about. So I think we could just drop that reference and just use the narrative description of where the buffer will exist. Or maybe require that we show the plan. But it really doesn't.
I don't see a reference to the actual illustration.
In number three.
Oh, number three of the there
will be an order. John, are you planning to put this on the plan, this, as we discussed?
Yes.
So I think just the reference on the plan would do the trick.
I'm okay with that.
Also, one number three, I'm not sure if you read, the deed for this lot shall be include reference to the 25 wide.
To the buffers.
To the buffer, okay, to the wetland buffer. Would you like to add, as amended, that the deed for this lot shall include reference to the wetland buffer? Do you see it on there? Oh, you don't have the revised one.
I don't.
Okay. Would anyone like to make a motion on, or, yes, I'm seeing two hands up.
I just have a question. The deed to this lot being lot four, I question whether the deed to lot four needs that reference since none of the buffer is on lot four.
Okay. Is that, is, yeah.
Well, this lot doesn't have to be lot four. It can be the lot where the buffer is on. So, I guess.
When you say this lot.
We can correct this lot to make it clear that the deed for the lot where the wetland is the deed that is referenced. But the bigger question is, do you support a reference in the deed or do you not want to put that in the deed?
I guess my inclination would be not to. I don't know, I have to think about that because we're not proposing to do anything on that property at this point. I don't know, it's a good question.
Carol. She's mulling that.
Yes.
In number two.
Yes.
The additional planting of vegetation is we decided early on was not.
Yeah, we're not going to do that buffer. What else was since launching that? Oh, okay. Does anyone have the corrections that mentions the road maintenance agreement? Would they like to ask?
Okay. You want to add that?
You can ask Liza if she would like to add that.
May I add something to your motion?
What would that be, Caroline?
Regarding the road maintenance agreement. to add to the motion that a road maintenance agreement be provided in a form acceptable to the town attorney and the town manager, signed by the applicant and recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. The deed for lot four should also include deeded access and utility rights to Cardinal Lane.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Does anyone else?
No.
Have we agreed?
The sewer enforcement?
Is that?
I guess, Maureen, just where we decided to go 10, 25, 10, we've already taken care of that.
Okay.
Unless you would like to put that in there. No? Okay. And did we or did we not, Maureen, at this point add the deed for this lot shall include reference?
You have not officially added that.
Okay.
I propose to add that.
Okay.
Any deed of any portion of lot one that includes the area of the buffer shall include a reference to the buffer.
Right.
It's not very artfully stated.
Okay. Any other discussions then? You've okayed that. Do I hear a second then? Anyone like to make a second, please?
So maybe it should say any future deed of any portion of the property subject to the buffer shall include a reference to the buffer.
You got that?
What number would that be?
Could I make a comment on that?
Yes.
The likelihood that a condition on a future deed that we don't have to repair now that this is actually going to be remembered and put into it is nil. I mean, what we would have to do is record something now and attach it to the deed for the lot that exists right now.
But I'm not sure it makes much sense to put it in the deed to lot four either.
No, not lot four.
Lot four.
The lot that has the wetland on it.
So lot one would need to
you could record some instrument that is attached to the deed for lot one that references this. But if you put a note on here that talks about a future deed, there's just no way I can ever imagine that's going to actually. The only thing a note like that's going to do is get you in trouble when people come back and they say, why didn't you make them do that? Because there's no way we'll remember that.
it's got to be a condition that we can implement now as part of this.
So between who and who?
It would be possible to, I mean, the applicant owns the lot that has the RP2 wetland. So the applicant could record something that attaches to that lot that talks about this buffer requirement.
File a declaration?
There you go.
I don't think that's binding on anyone. It would create, it would be something in the title, but it wouldn't bind anyone other than the person who filed it, unless it had somebody who was benefited by it, like a conservation easement sort of thing, where you need two parties.
But there would be also something on the plan. But the problem is trying to connect your approval to some unrelated action in the future that may not pull the planning board back in.
I understand your dilemma.
Yeah.
Is there a reason it's not accurate, sufficient to just have it on the site plan?
Well, the concern is that, you know, someone comes in 6 years from now, none of us are here, and they create a lot, and the lot has frontage, and no one remembers to pull this plan, no one remembers to look at the notes, and things are done.
But nevertheless, the wetland will still be there, and they will want to build within that. And they would want to build within that certain area, and whatever the prevailing rules are at that particular time would prevail, no doubt.
I guess I'm trying to be a little bit more careful with trying to preserve your intent into the future, because we definitely have run into trouble with this kind of idea.
Yeah, I see.
Is the road maintenance agreement recorded?
It should be, yes.
So could this note be added to the road maintenance agreement?
I don't see why not.
It's a road maintenance agreement, not a requirement about buffering on a wetland.
But at least a portion of this buffer relates to the road. That at least would be an agreement among more than...
Well, that's only the 10 feet, surely. I mean, you can't go beyond that area of a road.
Could you?
You could.
Yeah.
You certainly could.
Okay. Then
and that would
more
be
in line with what you're saying is that it's more binding, it has more...
That would then tie the hands of any future person developing this development. That the planning board in the future could then not simply remove that restriction without getting the permission of all the parties to the road maintenance agreement.
Wow, that's helpful, man.
Assuming everyone signs the amendment to the road maintenance agreement.
Any discussion on that? And okay, Liza?
I defer to the lawyers, the two lawyers.
Okay.
Yeah.
You made the original motion. Will you accept that motion?
Yeah.
You okay?
Excuse me, can I get the wording?
So I think it would be an addition to the section on the road maintenance agreement, which I think is now, I'm not sure if it's 6 or 7 or 5. Anyway, the one that talks about the road maintenance agreement would say it would include the road maintenance agreement shall include the reservation of a buffer as described in condition 3.
You think that would work? I mean,
okay.
You're going
that
40,
was accepted by Liza, and
yes.
We already have a second on that.
Yeah.
Okay. Then, any further discussion on this? Okay. Thank you. Then, all those in favor? Okay. Those not in favor, and those abstaining. Thank you, Henry. Okay. We are done with this item. Thank you.
Because I didn't agree with it. And I didn't want to oppose it. I just decided, assuming that you were with the lawyer, and you were looking at it.
Okay. Dangerous.
The end of the lawyer is today, and I agree.
Thank you.
We can do that. We had a motion for that.
Folks all set? You all set down on this end?
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep moving. It's getting late, past bedtimes. Okay, so the next item on the agenda, the Sea Salt Market Site Plan Amendment. This item will be addressed in the following format. Town planner will provide a summary of the project, after which the applicant will summarize the proposed changes to the site plan. The public is then welcome to comment on the completeness of the project, after which the board will determine completeness. The application is deemed complete, then the public is welcome to comment on the project. After public comment, the board may begin discussion, including decision on whether a site walk and/or public hearing should be scheduled, and we will conclude with a motion for the board to consider. Maureen, do you have an overview summary?
Sure, I'll try to keep it short. This is in the Town Center District. It is a site plan amendment, so you have approved the original site plan. The applicant has proceeded in good faith with the site plan that was approved. As is not uncommon with construction of sites, there have been some small changes that have come up during the process. The code officer is taking a very literal line on site plan approvals and has recommended that the applicant return to the planning board for a series of what are minor amendments. I guess I want to make sure the board understands that the applicant is under construction right now, is hoping to open next month, and that the board can be nimble in processing what are intended to be minor changes. Any questions?
No. Any questions? Okay.
Hey, thank you. Represent Mike Concannon and family who are here this evening in this application for an amended site plan, as well as a request to establish a phase two to this project. Specifically, the amendments include an existing tree that is located right here that was originally scheduled to be removed, and we would like to preserve that existing tree. The second amendment includes the property line fence along this property line here. Originally, we had proposed a 6-foot-high solid wood fence to extend from the beginning near Ocean House Road back 137 linear feet. The amendment would include increasing the height of the fence to 7 feet. We've worked with Andrew Blake, who's here this evening, the abutter, in trying to address his concerns. So we've agreed to extend it to a height of 7 feet versus 6 feet that was approved, with the top 1 foot to be a lattice fence, a lattice style on the top 12 inches. We have in addition to that, we are also proposing a the first section of fence would be a transition fence, which would begin at 4 feet and then extend up to the 7-foot height. The third item has to do with the handicap ramp, which is located in the rear of the building in this area here. We have modified that. Initially, we had 2 stone walls incorporated into the handicap ramp. We have replaced the interior wall with granite curbing. So that is the third amendment. And then finally, plantings. We've increased the quantity of plantings in the handicap ramp area. So those are the four minor revisions or amendments that we're requesting. As I mentioned, we're also requesting that we establish a phase two to this project. The four items that would be included, that would be completed next year, include a stone wall surrounding the patio, We have, as part of the patio, we designed a circular stone wall to enclose the patio. That would be done next year. A stone wall opening. Originally, we had the wall connecting to the building. We'd like to provide a 5-foot opening so patrons can circulate out to the sidewalk along Ocean House Road without going back inside the building. The third would be to, associated with the stone wall, are concrete pavers, and we'd like to do that next year, as well as the lattice fence surrounding the circular portion of the patio. So those four items we're asking that to be included in Phase 2, which would be done next year.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. And at this time, this is scheduled for the public to speak on whether or not this is complete. If anyone wants to say whether or not everything before the board, we have the information or not, this is on completeness. There'll be a second opportunity for people to speak if they have, yes, okay. So this is just whether or not you think the plans are complete. Okay, seeing no one from the public, then I will ask the board, do you have any comments on completeness? No, anyone like to make a motion on completeness?
No.
Thank you, Elaine.
Motion for the board to consider a motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Mike Concannon of KMC Properties LLC for amendments to the previously approved site plan for the Sea Salt Market located at 349 Ocean House Road be deemed complete.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Joe, for a second. Okay, all those in favor of completeness? Okay, unanimous. All right, it's deemed complete. So now the public is now welcome to come up and to the podium to speak on the project itself.
My name's Andrew Blake. I live at 351 Ocean House Road, which abuts this property that's being worked on, or the applicant. I have some concerns about the proposed buffer with the lattice top. With the adjustments in the grade of the land from the initial site proposal, I'm really concerned about headlights sweeping my property continuously, and it would be for probably 3 to 4 hours over evenings and winters. And Mike has been great with working with me and including me in this process and talking about buffers. I would like to continue to work with him, but a combination of fencing or deciduous trees or evergreens to provide that buffer, because me and my family, we would find it probably very distracting to have the headlights sweep. If you look at the top left corner of the land over by the community center, that land is level with my windows, and the 1-foot lattice that's proposed in the current buffer would provide very little barrier. I'd have constant lights going through from traffic from the high school entrance, also any cars backing up and moving or navigating in the parking lot. I sent a letter to this effect. I'm not focused too much on fence height or trees. It's just whatever will work to provide me the maximal buffer so my family's life is not impacted as much as it could be.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak on this item?
Good evening. My name is Jim Clark. I live at 350 Ocean House Road, which is right across the street from Cecil. And I just met Mike for the first time. This is a great opportunity for me to comment. Is there a limit on how long I have?
3 minutes.
Thank you. Is the clock running?
Yes.
Okay. I have a few points I'd like to raise. Some of them are informational in nature. Some are representative of questions or concerns that my wife Ann and I have. None of them I view to be extraordinary or significant. However, since I'm new, this is an opportunity for me to weigh in. Out of the items that I have, the one I'm most concerned about is the light that's at the rear of the parking lot. When it shines pretty much, kind of like Andy described, directly into a view that we have coming out of our house. So one of my questions is whether or not the angle of that light or the height of the light in the back of the parking lot could be adjusted appropriately. Some of the other questions I have around control for litter, hours of operation, attempts to control noise overall, somewhat like what we heard around vehicles, wind erosion. And with regard to wind erosion in particular, under construction, we were surprised at how incredibly dirty our windows were as a result. I think of not only the winter, but also the construction. I don't anticipate that being a concern or question once we're finished with the project. But the question is, how much thought may have gone into ensuring that soil doesn't continue to fly across the street or go anywhere, for that matter, after the construction's done. The final question I have goes back to the fencing. I'm just curious as to why is it that the design of the fence is 4 feet and then up to 7, as opposed to 7 all the way through. I'm just curious as to what that, what the thought process was behind that. I think that's it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else like to speak? No? We're going to close this then. Okay. Now, would anyone on the board? Yes, Henry.
Yeah. Sorry.
Microphone.
I took a walk down and had a look over the site, and on the map that I have, it's not shown up there, the residence on the left-hand side, I guess, looking at it, is shown. It's not shown on that one. And I noticed that you couldn't actually see this residence from the parking lot very easily. You had to maneuver quite a lot to be able to see the residence. And so I traced the lines of cars going down, and the only area that I could see where the lights would actually illuminate the residence were at the, now this is difficult, but I'll show you up here. If the car's coming down here and sweeping around, they're going to illuminate the residence there. It is a possibility, of course, if they come in down this road, as they sweep around the corner, they will possibly touch there. If the cars are allowed to come down this way, then because the residence is here, they didn't really see it illuminating the residence that much. It seemed to be relatively well hidden, and you know, it's not that it appeared to me, anyway, from where I was looking, to be a real major problem if the traffic is routed around this parking lot in the correct way. With regard to lights shining down, I thought they were the type that pointed down onto the ground and not allowed the light to go all around. And so I don't see that as a great problem with light pollution. With regard to noise, it is the center of town, and you know, those are one of those problems to do with traffic in actually living in the center of a town. So that's my comments on it anyway.
Thank you, Henry. Would anyone else like to comment on this project? Yes.
Excuse me, the application at the moment is for minor variations in the way the development will be finished. Mm-hmm. Are we being asked to reopen any of the approvals that were initially made? Some of the comments seem addressed to that.
You can reopen anything. And there has been a change with the fence. So there has been a change
sure.
made. And we now heard from the neighbor, Mr. Blake, that he has concerns about that. And he not necessarily is demanding a higher fence. He's saying he's open to other types of plantings. So, yes, anything is actually open for discussion.
Understood. Mr. Blake, I believe, showed up the first time and his ideas were heard. You know, I'm asking the question, not trying to take any position, but if Mr. Concannon had not come in with this with these tweaking of the approvals, that the fencing would have been a done deal. Am I correct? It couldn't have been reopened because Mr. Blake didn't care for what had been approved some months ago.
Right. If they were not back before us,
right.
You're right.
Okay.
Yeah.
But we can, because of the request, go back in and look at other aspects as Mr. Blake has asked us to do. That's, okay.
Yes, and the Concans have come back and said we will actually we'll change the fence that we initially proposed. But Mr. Blake is also saying he still has some concerns.
Right, okay, got it.
So at this time, if anyone on the board would like to look into anything else that's on this plan, including buffering, now's the opportunity.
Could I ask Mr. Blake something? I like Henry, I drove down and around the facility, and it struck me that cars coming south on Route 77 turning right into the parking lot would, to some extent, perhaps sweep your property. The cars coming out of the parking lot and back,
I think so,
as their headlights focused on your property, seem to be mostly behind your house. The sweeping of your house, maybe when they hit the turn, is that the point of concern?
Peter, I always appreciate when we try to have bring in people to speak, but the public hearing is actually over. So unfortunately,
this is true.
Mr. Blake cannot, but I thought he did a good job, because that was the time for any follow-ups. I think he did a good job saying he's not necessarily coming in here and saying, I need that 8-foot fence. But he's saying, is there the possibility of additional plantings? What can we do? And he did send us the photographs. I went out to the property myself today, and what I saw was that the grading of sea salt is a little higher than your property, and I saw the lowest spot is where the fence currently sits. I would ask John to maybe possibly describe where the fence will be, because right now it actually seems like the fence, not just the post, but the actual fence is sort of sitting in dirt. So what kind of, when you put the new fence in, because it will be a new fence, so when you put the new fence in, remind me what the material is, and if you will actually, will the fence actually be touching the ground, or will the fence actually be up just a little bit more?
It will be raised above.
So it will come up a little bit more.
What you see is existing grade, you know, it will be raised above a few inches.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to clarify one thing. Andrew indicated that there were adjustments in the grade. There have not been any adjustments in the grades. The grades that are out there now are the grades that were approved on the original site plan. I think Andrew's concern is that probably the grades that are out there were not anticipated to be as high as they are, but there were no adjustments in the grades. I just want to make that clear.
Okay.
The fence will be, as we indicated, there's a detail on the drawings. It's a solid wood fence with a cap along the top and a intermediate rail. And then, as I mentioned, the top 12 inches will be a lattice-style fence. We did that to provide a bit of, you know, decorative style rather than having a solid 7-foot high fence. We thought that with having the lattice, it provided a little bit more of a residential feel to it.
Okay, and the reason, so we could answer the other neighbor's question, that you went the first few feet or four.
Again,
four
that, foot. That's it's an aesthetic touch to it. I mean, it's quite normal to have a transition piece rather than an abrupt 7 feet right at the end. It's just a more pleasing style to the fence.
Which the board agreed to, and I'm not hearing anyone disagreeing with that at this moment. So just to answer the neighbor. Yes.
Yeah, Victoria, I didn't mean to bring Mr. Blake back into the fray. What I was trying to do, though, is clarify and understand at what point on the fence line is there sensitivity? Is it the entire fence line, or are there points where headlights actually do, you know, sweep his house, where these buffer issues could be focused?
I think I can answer that if you're not allowing Andrew to speak. We've communicated.
Yes.
I think, Andrew, and you can nod if you don't agree with this, but, Andrew's primary concern is towards the rear, where the parking lot is in relation to his property. And this area would be in Andrew's backyard. You agree? So I think that's where your primary concern is. As I mentioned, we've had two or three conversations with Andrew. We really do want to address his concerns, and Mike has indicated that that he would be willing to, once the new fence is up and the market is open, to relook at the buffering concerns of Andrew and to address his concerns then.
Would that require coming back?
No, unless you...
No, okay. I just want to make sure you don't have to come back. I appreciate having discussions because I was going to make suggestions. I can see some plantings, and they're shrubs. Do you see where I'm speaking? Closer to the school than to the road? Yeah, right there. And I was just going to say, it seems like what you have is you'll have the fence, which will catch the first seven feet, and then you have your evergreens, which have grown taller than, the lowest branches are taller than 7 feet. Maybe they go up to 9. There's just this area, it almost appears, that is when you have a break in between the trees that possibly is just not being blocked. Otherwise, it's a good solid. I agree with Henry. It was a good solid barrier where the trees do, where they are planted. But
right.
But if you're willing to have continued conversations after the fence goes in, I think that's great. And as long as you don't have to come back, I wouldn't want to see the expense of coming back to the board. You know, so I don't know if we need to settle that tonight. But Henry, you have a question.
Yeah, well, I wondered if you could impose a little bit of traffic control by putting in where cars would head. In other words, instead of aiming down the car park at the house and sweeping around, if they were directed down and around to the side entrance, that way it would stop the lights actually shining into the house. Because it's only on that swing, two places. If they're not allowed to come down this part, then you want to eliminate the house, and it's this swing, and this doesn't eliminate the house, but when the cars swing around, obviously the light is going to hit the house. So if they weren't allowed, if there was an arrow pointed that way, and they weren't allowed to have some sort of traffic control, I think you could eliminate quite a lot of the light actually hitting the house.
Would anyone like to follow up on that comment?
Yeah, I would rather see more buffering than traffic control, and as many of you probably recall, when this application first came up, I didn't think the buffering was adequate. I still don't. The ordinance on page 91 says for non-compatible adjacent uses, and in the picture, there's a house next to a business, that they require wider buffers and earth berms or wood fences, so wider buffers and earth berms or wood fences for a physical separation. Denser massing of deciduous and evergreen planting provides for seasonal variation and buffer continuity. And the picture has a very wide buffer of plantings of both deciduous and evergreen where the residence is next to the business. And so I think that it's very reasonable to require more plantings next to that fence. I think the additional foot is a start, but I think that the ordinance is crystal clear.
Okay, thank you, Liza. I just want to follow up on that. I'm hearing that this should be settled tonight with additional buffering, and I'm also hearing Henry made a suggestion about changing where the traffic comes through. Does anyone like to follow up on those items or comments? Yes, Peter?
Yeah, I don't follow the changing of the traffic pattern because that's really one of the primary points of access and egress to the property. The incompatible uses, this is within the town center zone, in which residential and commercial uses are permitted. So the incompatibility, it does exist, but I'm not quite sure to what full force the buffering requirement should be taken. The idea that they've been talking and seem to be, you've gotten quite a ways along to solving the problem, strikes me as very healthy. And I'm just wondering if they can sort this out. I agree with Henry that it's where the cars turn, coming out of the back or turning in off the street where the house will be swept. Is there anything else you can do in the fence line that will mitigate that?
Short of increasing the fence.
Or are there spots in the fence where you could create some additional, like an arc lattice that would be, I don't know.
Why not just plant a big tree?
How big a tree?
Blue spruce?
John, you have a tree in the corner, the left, that lower left corner, right?
Yes.
How big does that get? What is it?
Do you have a set of plans?
I do.
Right, existing. What kind it is? It's very overgrown in that area when I went over today. It's very overgrown. I would suggest not taking that down because, right, that whole area is very overgrown. It does protect that corner very well.
The other plant materials see in this area here are proposed. They're viburnums that grow 7 to 8 feet high and Cornus dogwood. What we could do is to relook at possibly, rather than putting in the medium-sized shrubs, we could look at putting in a larger tree in that location. In this location. To help prevent the wash of lights.
I mean, there's two clusters of shrubs. If you could just trade out of those two clusters, trade out one shrub and put a tree in there instead.
Put a tree in, right.
And the question I would ask the board, are you okay with a deciduous tree? Because that gives the applicant a lot of flexibility with space, and it does provide a lot of, I mean, even though leaves are gone in the winter, mm-hmm. it still provides a lot of buffer.
I'm fine with deciduous. Other people on the board? You did deciduous instead of the nevergreen? Yes.
Surely, I mean, the leaves in the summer will take care of it, but the winter is when the lights come on the most because that's when it gets dark early. So if you've got no leaves, you lose a certain amount of that buffering. So whilst I don't want to push the point too much, I would have thought a little bit of control over where the lights are arcing would go quite some way to alleviate the problem. I know the gentleman can't speak, but you know, I would also like to propose that maybe in this particular one we could take one or two comments from the public, if that's permissible. Well, maybe not.
Yeah, we can't. Yes, I would.
So, Maureen, you were just referring to what you were looking at. Is that sheet four of the plan?
Yes.
And there are two clumps of, I think, new things. One is V period CPS, one.
Right, so I guess I was looking in the rear, which is after you get past all the evergreens on the abutter's property, there's a clump of three, and I believe they're
I understand there's a clethra and a viburnum, right. Neither of which I think get tall enough to be higher than that fence anyway. They would make the fence look prettier from the residence.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But neither clethra nor viburnum are going to grow up 8 feet tall, I don't think. At least.
And that was the thought, that if we could take at least one of those and magically turn it into a tree that would grow taller than a typical tree.
Eventually.
Without losing the leaves?
Well, I'm suggesting that even a deciduous tree would be good. In that area, it looks like there's enough space that you could put in an evergreen. You'd have to push the shrubs away. If you look at the cluster closer to the road, there's a cluster of five, and they're basically in the middle. They're in between the three and the gap between the three and the three evergreens.
One,
yes.
Two, three, four, five. Yeah.
And that's that in that area, you are getting, it's getting pretty tight, and that was the area where I thought if you were to put, replace one of those, again, I think we've got some
pepper
of those
bush.
Lovely clethras, which is really a really lovely shrub. I have several.
I think what I would recommend, Maureen, is
yep.
rather than, because I don't think deciduous shrub or tree, deciduous tree is going to address Andrew's concern, particularly in the wintertime. I think I would, to replace those, what are there, four? There are four.
There's five.
There are five.
There's five.
Is
a cluster of four and a cluster of three.
Is to take and put in some arborvitaes. Because a spruce or a pine or hemlock, it's going to grow too large to fit that space. But arborvitaes are somewhat, you can maintain those, and they're going to provide the year-round evergreen for the...
They also grow quite quickly.
And they grow quite, once they're established, they'll put on a foot a year.
In which area? In the area where there's a cluster of three?
Right in this area.
The
cluster
of five, I think.
No, because the five is much closer to 77, which isn't the area of concern anyway.
Okay, so you do it back there.
So
substitute for the three clethras. How many arborvitaes would you want?
The three clethra in this, isn't there a one?
There's one on each side.
Is it Shasta?
So in place of those, to put in, let's say, three arborvitaes.
That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Does the board have any?
I could go with that.
Any comments on that? Changing this buffer slightly?
Could you restate what it?
So can you, I'm hearing that the board is in agreement with what you're proposing, John. So then could you just one more time that the board actually hears what you're proposing?
Right.
Just going right down the line.
In lieu of the four shrubs that are located in this cluster here, mm-hmm. we would replace those with three arborvitaes. And okay. They will be strategically placed to minimize the glare.
Mm-hmm. I think that with the extra foot on the fence is great.
You approve? Okay. All right. Anyone have any? I'm trying to look at the sweep. That cluster of five. Anyone concerned with the cluster of five with the lights? I'm not sure if a car. Yeah, I'm not sure if the car sweeps through. Henry, you're kind of more engineering. If they swept through, they wouldn't hit the house.
Oh, I think they would. If they're sweeping down the lot and turning to go out the bottom area there, I think they would block it, yes.
Yeah, okay. So we're just looking at that cluster of three and the one next to it.
Whatever you do, you're going to get a certain ripple light coming through to the house. I mean, there's no doubt about that. A light sweeping through is going to find a few little openings in the... I'll repeat it. Whatever you do, you're going to have little ripplings of light come through, but it won't be a glare. It'll be sort of like a twinkling star, if that's a better analogy.
Okay. Anyone else have any questions about the buffer? No, because we had some questions from another gentleman in the audience. Can you just remind the board about... the light coming off the property, about how we've already had the candlelight
right.
test. Can you just remind the board about that and hours of operation?
Okay, I'm going to ask Mike on that one, but with regard to the lighting, we submitted as part of our approval a photometric plan that illustrated the level of foot candles at the property line, and they met the standard in your ordinance, the site plan standards.
Yes.
I think it's a half a foot candle.
Yes.
So, but we can also adjust these light fixtures if there's a, is there a concern, is that the fixture you're concerned about?
It's the one in the back.
Oh, it's the one in the back. Okay. Well, these luminaires were able to adjust them, so to minimize the glare.
Okay. Thank you. That'd be nice. Hours of operations, just to, you'll have to come up.
As of now, we're thinking like 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. and
okay.
not exactly sure, but that's roughly what we're thinking. Sundays, a little different than that, a little closing a little earlier.
And I think you had mentioned before that that the lights in your lot will automatically turn
so
off.
So we have them on timers that right. We can probably, you know, an hour after the store closes for people to finish cleaning and so they can clear everything out so the employees can have some light when they leave.
Right, so they won't be left on overnight?
No, an hour, I would say an hour, hour and a half after we close.
Okay.
There are two town center lights, and I'm not sure what the policy is for the town center.
It would not be determined by this board.
Okay.
I just wanted to
okay.
make sure that everyone stood there.
Yes.
I just want to say, because I know I've taken a lot of comments regarding hours of operation of businesses, and I just want to make sure everyone is clear and understanding that there's no limit on what the hours of operation for a business in the town center. And what the applicant just said was what his general intent is, and there's nothing that says that he can't be open earlier or later as he chooses.
Right, I do agree with that. Right, but you had mentioned it, and we have somebody here that asked the question.
Yeah.
You would know better than I would. I'm sure litter will not be an issue. I'm sure you're going to be keeping this property spotless. And you are almost done. So any of the any drifting of soil off of the property, we hope that will end because you don't want to see your topsoil blow away. So,
correct.
Right, okay, because you're almost done. Anyone else think of any questions that were raised that I have not answered? Elaine?
One thing we talked about, I guess it must have been at the workshop when we just discussed the phasing, is that if the construction of the round wall and the lattice on top of that is going to be deferred, that those structures were intended to provide some additional barrier to against noise or light. People who might choose to be eating outside, and we talked about a restriction that would say that there would not be any seating on the patio until those phase two improvements were completed. And I didn't see, then there was some mention that, well, you thought you might have some benches there, and we had asked if you intend to have benches that you show them on the site plan, and I don't see any of that discussion reflected on the plans, and I didn't know what you were. I would propose that no outdoor seating be permitted until phase two is completed.
The bench is shown. That's the bench.
I thought that was pretty cool.
It looks like a bench to me, 2 foot bench.
We talked about that at the workshop, and I didn't know if you'd had any further thoughts on that.
Yeah, I'm sorry I wasn't at the workshop, but I mean, we prefer to have some seating, perhaps benches, not actual table and seats, but to have some benches that patrons can go out there and sit.
But the idea of the wall and the lattice on top of the wall was to screen those outdoor diners from the traffic, but also to screen the adjacent property from the additional noise of people being outside, particularly in the evenings and early mornings.
Can I interject? Are you talking about benches under the porch on the paved area,
yeah,
or out on the, not on the lawn?
Front.
So.
I'd like to hear from the rest of the board about concerns about putting benches out there before we have the fence as a screen?
I'm not that concerned as long as it's under the porch, pushed sort of, I mean, the benches would probably end up against the wall because you want to sit with your back to the wall. So they'd be deep in the porch. So there's some screening as a result of that.
You look like you, Peter, did you have a comment?
No. My understanding also was the food service that would await the formal patio would be tables and chairs where you'd sit for a meal, and that if a patron bought a sandwich or something and sat outside on a bench, my reaction from the workshop was nobody was particularly concerned of that, which I continue to think is probably okay.
And Liza, did you have a comment?
Yeah, well, my recollection of the workshop is the same, and I would be okay with seating under the eaves, but not out beyond on what would be the phase two patio.
And any comment down here? Henry?
Well, as we're coming up to winter, it would be a pretty hardy type of person that was going to be eating out there all the time for phase two, so I'd be surprised. But I thought on the drawing you actually did show a bench, curved bench around the wall, 2 foot wide. Is that the bench, or are you proposing variable benches that can
be moved?
No,
there's no bench around the wall.
Shown on my map. Maybe on my drawing.
That's the stone wall.
That's a part of it.
You've got a stone wall, and then you've got a... Oh, right.
Okay. And then there's the lattice fence, which is included in phase two.
I mean, I can't really see a great deal of people eating out between now and the next phase. But
you don't know when the next phase necessarily is.
You've got quite a bit of winter coming on.
I know, but the next phase, I mean, even though it's planned for a year from now, it could be 3 years from now.
Yeah, but are you actually saying that we could stop people eating a sandwich outside regardless of whether there's a bench there or not? I find that a bit surprising. I mean, I walk in, I buy a sandwich, I decide where to eat it. I could eat it walking up and down the road or sitting on the wall without the benches being there. I don't understand. Sorry?
The wall won't be there either.
Right. So, would the board like to put any conditions or want to know the number of benches? I mean, what level of detail would you want? Elaine, you have a comment?
I would just propose that there be no table seating outside until the patio and the wall, until phase two is complete. No table seating.
So you've changed it from no outdoor seating to no table seatings. So no, is that what I'm hearing?
That would probably work, yeah.
Bench as well. Seating.
No tables.
I mean, you're talking tables only, but benches are okay?
Yes, that's
Sounds
what
like
I'm
it.
Hearing.
Yeah.
Or maybe just benches under the roof? I'm not sure. Have we seen a cross-section of it? I'm not sure how we would define it. Joe, you have a suggestion there?
Well, if you look at the plan, the darker area is, you can just show how far the roof comes.
It extends 12 feet, I believe, 12 feet out from the building.
Yeah, there's a row of columns.
Oh, I see. Right, and there's another 2 feet beyond that column. Because you've got 10 foot 3, does that represent the 18 feet
radius? Yeah, so the eaves go a little beyond the column. But so that you're sitting under the porch roof.
You'd be sitting right there.
Right in there. And there's an entry in about the center.
There's an entry right there.
I have one other question. What was the seating inside the closed area? Do you know how many seats and how many tables you've got in there?
16, 24.
Do you remember?
It was either 24 or 28.
Well, seating, but that included the outdoor.
Yeah.
That included the outdoor.
So you're saying 25 overall, including inside and outside?
Table seating.
When you get an approval, in theory, you're not supposed to have any more seats on the property than what you got approval
right.
for, whether they're indoors or outdoors.
So I guess my question is, what approval did we or they got.
Yeah.
Thank
He's
you.
Not proposing to change that.
Okay.
Right, and it's usually but, just seating. We never.
Yeah, I just want to remember what the total seating was proposed.
I think 28 on. Yeah, on your parking calculation, it's seven spaces, one space for four patrons, so it's 28.
28 total.
28 total.
Indoor and outdoor.
So I'm not hearing a lot of discussion on this. I am hearing that one board member does not want any tables out there until phase two is completed, but I am hearing that the rest of the board is saying that seating is fine. Okay, and then anyone want to make any conditions on the seating? I mean, how far do you want to take this? Do you just want to say no tables?
Yeah, maybe that a note be added to the plan restricting table seating to the completion of phase two.
Would that satisfy the board? Is that what you're looking for?
Not me. I don't think it should be imposed. I don't think it should be imposed.
Okay. So the majority of the board is just saying that no tables be placed out there, but if the benches, the seats, whatever, go out there, that would be fine, so people can sit down and enjoy. Okay. So we can, whoever makes that motion can add that condition to this. All right. Does anyone else have anything else they would like to comment in regards to this amendment? No. I don't have anything. You did say you went through the AMAC letter and you...
All of those items have been addressed and those will be included in our submission.
Right, okay. I'm not seeing anything. Does anyone else have anything? So, no, we just made a change in regards to some of the buffer and we're making a change in regards to outdoor tables. Anything else for the board?
Nope.
Want to consider?
Should I make a motion?
I would accept a motion.
All righty. Motion for the board to consider. Motion for approval. Findings of fact. Mike Kincannon of KMC Properties LLC is requesting amendments to the previously approved site plan for the Sea Salt Market, located at 349 Ocean House Road, which requires review under Section 19-9 Site Plan Regulations. Number two, the town engineer has recommended that additional detail information be added to the plans. Number three, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 Site Plan Regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Mike Kincannon of KMC Properties LLC for amendments to the previously approved site plan for the Sea Salt Market located at 349 Ocean House Road be approved, subject to the following conditions. Number one, that the plans be revised to address the comments of the town engineer in his letter dated August 13, 2014. Number two, that there be no certificate of occupancy issued until the plans have been revised to address the conditions of approval and submitted to the town planner for review. That should probably be number four. I'm going to call that number four. Number two, that the plans be revised to replace deciduous shrubbery with evergreen trees consistent with the planning board discussion. Can we get away with that?
Is that...
How about, can I make
yeah.
a suggestion?
Yeah.
Please do.
That the four shrubs in the southwest corner of the property be replaced with three arborvitae.
Great. That the four deciduous shrubs in the southwest corner be replaced with three evergreen arborvitae. Excellent.
John, do you want to offer a minimum size at time of planting?
Say 6 foot.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
6 foot height.
With a minimum size at time of planting of 6 feet.
With a minimum height at size of planting of 6 feet. Great.
Okay.
And then number three, that a note be added to the plan restricting table seating to the completion of phase two.
Okay.
And I already read number four.
Outdoor table seating.
Restricting, thank you, outdoor table seating.
Okay. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Carolyn. Is there any discussion on that motion? All those in favor of the motion? Okay, that is unanimous. We are complete.
Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry, yeah, we never did discuss the sidewalk. We're done, right?
Yeah, we're done.
All right. We're done. I rushed it a little bit, but we're done so that you can be completed on your time schedule. Okay. Thank you. And good luck. Sounds wonderful.
That would be bad.
No, I was fairly implied.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is any public comment on items not on tonight's agenda. Seeing no one, I am now going to ask if the board would like to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you. Do I hear a second? Thank you. The meeting is now over. We have adjourned. That was Jordan.